This is Mark 10, 1 through 12, divorce. Jesus then left that place and went into the region of Judea and crossed and across the Jordan. Again, crowds of people came to him, and as was his custom, he taught them. Some Pharisees came and tested him by asking, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" "What did Moses command you?" he replied. They said, "Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away. It was because your hearts were hard that Moses wrote you this law," Jesus replied. "But at the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." When they were in the house again, the disciples asked Jesus about this. He answered, "Anyone who divorces his wife and marries another woman commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another man, she commits adultery."
And then I found $20. All right. So anyways, okay. In case you didn't hear that, the text, it's been something I've been approaching with some dread. The reason why isn't so much because of what it says being something that I don't like, that I disagree with, but rather it's because of how emotionally sensitive this whole topic is. And my heart just kind of dreads bringing up painful memories. It dreads bringing up this for us because this is just so sensitive in our hearts, and we don't often hear what God has to tell us on this, and we instead kind of put a different message in his heart, in his mouth, because of our emotions. And not only that, you know, this issue of divorce, and then the connected one of remarriage, it's been an issue that has split a number of congregations in the past, although maybe not so much recently. And I think if we took a show of hands in our congregation, we're not going to do that, but if we did that, I think we would end up finding out that every single one of us has been personally touched by divorce. Every single one of us has. Whether it's because you personally have gone through a divorce, or your parents have, your auntie, your uncle, someone who is really close to you in that way, maybe your siblings. All of us have experienced divorce and often remarriage. And because of that, as we consider it, our hearts can get just so emotionally ramped up in this, and we don't hear what God has to say to us. We just hear a thing, we remember what's happened, and it's just our minds kind of shut down a little bit. And so today what we're going to do is we're going to really focus on what God wants us to hear. What does God want us to hear in this? And what does he not want us to hear? That's what we're going to focus on. And as a result of that, I think what's going to happen is we're going to come away with a better understanding of God and his will for our lives. Namely, that he is a God who loves us and who desires to bless us. And so with that, let's pray. Father, I thank you that you have given us yourself, that you have loved us, that you've committed to us. And Lord, I ask that we would hear that today and also mourn how we fail to commit to others and how others have failed to commit to us, and show us the love that you desire to be shown. In your name we pray. Amen. So our text begins with Jesus going around the region of Judea beyond the Jordan. When the Pharisees come up to him, again, to just kind of test him a little bit, kind of trap him, and they say, "Hey, Jesus, what do you think? Is it okay for a guy to divorce his wife?" And in Matthew's version of this account, we hear the clarifying question at the end of the question: "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any reason?" And at the time, this was actually a really hotly debated issue in Judaism because of a couple different interpretations of Deuteronomy 24:1. And the Pharisees reference that passage to Jesus here. In Judaism, there was a school of Shammai that said that a man could not divorce his wife unless he found unchastity in her. And then there was variation on what that meant. But the school of Hillel said that he could divorce his wife even if she just spoiled a dish for him, or if he found someone else to be more fair than her. He could get a divorce. He'd write her a certificate of divorce, give it to her, and then he's done. It's over. And as we learn from Matthew's account, you can read this sometime if you want, Jesus, he seems to be more in line with the school of Shammai, or rather the school of Shammai seems to be more in line with him, noting that it's only on the basis of sexual infidelity that someone should be able to get a divorce. In Mark, though, Jesus just says, yeah, I know Moses told you that you could get a divorce, but he only gave you that commandment because your hearts are so cold and hard. In the beginning, it was not that way. And the effect of Mark's account here, it's less about Jesus telling us to find a box that we can check so that we can get a biblical divorce, and it's more about grieving the reality of the fact that divorce is sometimes necessary in this life. Because our hearts are cold and hard and stubborn, sometimes divorce is a necessary thing in this life. And so here, Jesus doesn't claim that divorce is never an appropriate option, but rather that it is sometimes a necessary evil on account of a greater evil. It's not a good thing per se, and it's never to be celebrated. But it is necessary at times to preserve good. And the reason why is summed up in the general sense of the word adultery. In the general sense of the word adultery. We're familiar with the narrow sense of that word, which is, you know, to have sex with someone who isn't your spouse while you're married. And that's the very narrow understanding of that word. But there's also a more general sense of this word, which seems to be what Jesus is talking about here and elsewhere, of just being unfaithful to your spouse, of breaking your marital vows, which said you'd commit to someone until death. At times, you have to do that. That's why in Matthew 5, Jesus even says, if you divorce your wife as a man, you make your wife, your former wife, an adulterer. And it doesn't even go into remarriage at all. But what the point that he's getting at is you're forcing that person to say no to something they were supposed to say yes to their whole life. It's just the general sense of the word adultery. And so the essence of divorce then is adultery. It's the breaking of a marital union. And unfortunately, there are times when divorce is needed because of a sin, because of the sin of breaking faith within the marriage. And so, as we see elsewhere in Scripture, in cases of adultery in the narrow sense, where trust is potentially broken beyond hope of repair, or in cases of abuse, where civic responsibilities to not harm another person are torn down, or in cases of abandonment, where one's commitments to each other are not able to be met, there are times when divorce is a necessary evil in order to protect the vulnerable from further oppression. It's sort of like why we go to war. Killing a human life that God has created is wrong. Killing someone who has not personally harmed you is doubly wrong. But there are times when killing another human life is necessary in order to guard against something worse from happening. This is why we go to war, and why we commit that evil action. There's times when killing a human life is necessary in order to guard against something worse from happening. It's, you know, as bad as the estimated 75, and I know there's variations on the numbers here, but as bad as the estimated 75 million deaths as a result of World War II were, the prospect of allowing Nazi Germany to just run rampant across the whole world and expand their rule without barrier, without being checked, was even worse. You know, I think if we talk to anyone, or at least most people who were alive during that time, knowing what we know now, they would make that same trade to send our sons overseas to go fight that evil, to go kill people. We would make that decision again and again and again because the prospect of Nazi Germany expanding their rule and oppressing people with killing millions and millions of Jews and other people groups, that's just something that would be even greater cost than the millions of deaths that we encountered. Sometimes something so evil as war is necessary to preserve good from being destroyed by another person. And divorce is similar to war in actually many ways. It's an evil thing. It's not a good thing. It's an evil thing to break commitment to one that you have joined your life to for life. It's an evil thing to break faith in your marriage, to commit adultery in the general sense. It's an evil thing to break up a home. It's evil to break all chance of a relationship ever being restored, but sometimes it is necessary in order to prevent further harm from being done on the vulnerable. But like war and other necessary evils, divorce, it's often prematurely entered into. Divorce and war, they're basically supposed to be the last resort to dire situations. They're necessary at times, but as history has shown us with war, divorces are all too often entered into way too lightly. I think if we looked at most of the wars that we've been involved in, most of those are things that we should not have been involved in. There were other options available to us, and we just went into them anyways. And the same thing holds with divorces. People are often not prone to exploring all the other available options that they have to repair a relationship. And instead, they opt too fast to just blow the whole thing up. And the resulting devastation is felt on all kinds of people for generations to come. And this is why, by the way, we have made divorce a terribly difficult thing to do in our country. It's a heck of a lot harder to get a divorce than it is to get married. I think right now it's like a 6-month waiting period, I think, in Washington to get a divorce, and it's 3 days to get married. It's really easy to get married, guys, just so you know. Almost anyone can do it. It's really hard to get a divorce. And the reason why is, well, there's actually a lot of really good reasons. We need to make it hard for people to get a divorce because we need to understand the weight of it. We often don't account for how devastating a divorce is, and we need all these barriers to cross in order to discourage people from engaging in it all willy-nilly. Is it willy-nilly a thing that people say here? I don't know. I don't know if it's a Midwest thing or not. But what is it about divorce that makes it so devastating? What is it that makes it so devastating? Our text today doesn't really get into everything that we're going to talk about here in a bit, but I think it's important to observe some general truths from the rest of Scripture and also just our lived experience with divorce and its cause, which is adultery in the general sense. It's important for us to kind of feel the weight of this, and we could talk about a lot more than this, but I put this in terms of 5 D's. 5 D's about divorce and its cause that really destroys, really devastates life in that way. And we'll see if this works here. Yeah, okay, so the first thing about divorce and its cause is that it disorders your life. You know, when you take into consideration all the interdependence that gets developed in a marriage over the course of years together, it really becomes daunting to ever stop being married. You think about what that actually means. Everything from how to pay bills to how to structure your day, it's shaped by your relationship to your spouse. And so when you get a divorce, or someone divorces you, your life is being disordered in every aspect. Every aspect of how you live your life. Often it means buying a different car or finding a new house. Maybe sometimes it's possibly a new job, new ways to cope with life, a new church often, if your spouse keeps going to the other church. And while a divorce, it's merely the formal expression of what has been happening that has led to the divorce adds that level of finality to it. Divorce puts the fork in it, and it forces you down the road of disordering and having to reorder every aspect of your life. Now, that's the first D, and it's just a preamble to the others. The second one is that divorce and its cause disintegrates your social relationships. Now, this isn't to say that all of your relationships that you had when you were married are no longer available to you, but it is to say that they are fundamentally altered. You know, a similar thing happens, by the way, when you get married. If you are doing it right, your relationship to your parents, your siblings, your friends, and everyone else that you're close to in this life changes as a result of your marriage. And this is why I like to tell couples that when they're planning their wedding, they're also sort of planning their funerals. Because scripture tells us that in marriage, God is joining two people, two lives, into one joint life. And so no longer are you to interact with them as you used to. They now belong to another person. Their loyalties they shift to that person. And a lot of this, of course, is really, you know, difficult to stomach for those of us who are left behind and we liked that person when they were single and they belonged to us. And so marriage, you know, when you get married, it shifts your loyalties and all these sorts of things. It's not all roses when you get married. But now in divorce, all of those connections that you have formed as a couple are divided. And the nature of them is fundamentally altered. You know, everyone who knew you as a couple now feels like they need to take sides. And maybe this is just like a minor detail, but I think it's worth noting here, because the reality is that everyone you hold dear was once supporting you and your spouse to stick together. But when you go through the process of divorce, you're asking them to come alongside you in seeking the destruction of that relationship. And so at the very, very least, your relationship to them is disintegrated and a new relationship has to form. And as countless divorcees that I've talked to can attest to, many of those relationships never do get reformed. This is the reality of it. Divorce and its cause disintegrates our social relationships, which leads to the third D here. And that is that divorce and its cause disrupts our ability to care for children. And I want to be really careful to note here that a very unhealthy marriage is not a healthy place to raise children. And also that there are many cases that we all probably know of where the divorce of a marriage ended up working out a heck of a lot better for the children than if the two people just stay together in a ridiculously contentious marriage, okay? You know, my mom being raised by her birth mom and her stepdad is a really good example of it. Her birth dad abandoned my grandma. Abandoned her mom. And the guy that came in, it's a gem. And he really loved my mom and the other kids. He really cared for them. It really worked out a heck of a lot better for Ted to get involved in my grandma's life than for Gilbert to be in that life. And so I'm not speaking down on step parents or single parent homes at all. Don't hear me saying that, okay? Instead, what I'm observing is that in general, the best home for children is a home where they have their father and mother available to them to care for them and to guide them. And there's certainly exceptions to the rule. But divorce generally, if we just look at the numbers, divorce generally results in the suffering of children. They often feel like they need to take sides, that they were to blame for the divorce, that they're responsible to get their parents back together. And they're also usually lacking in the financial benefits that they normally would have had. But more than all of that, the biggest loss that children of divorced couples suffer is the loss of a father and mother team that devotes themselves to their care. They lose that clear expression of love and devotion that they can then model in their future relationships. And so they have to seek it out from other people. You know, they don't have the security of having both parents available to them. And instead, you know, a visitation schedule has to get established, you know, just to make sure that they have access to the other parent. And the reality is that many couples fail to realize is that their children are often the ones who suffer the most in a divorce. It's usually the case. It's not the parents who suffer the most. It's the children who usually do. But again, divorce is sometimes a necessary evil. We've got to acknowledge the exceptions to the rule. We've got to acknowledge that raising children in a continually contentious home is not necessarily better than even in a single-parent home. Divorce is sometimes a necessary evil, and Jesus is not saying it should never happen here, okay? But to disregard its effects on the children is nothing other than negligence. We have to account for that anytime this is about to take place. And so divorce and its cause, it disrupts our ability to care for children, and steps have to be taken to make sure that we can care for them after the fact. That's the third D. The fourth D is that divorce and its cause disregards the continual need for repentance and faith in our lives. Something that, you know, often gets lost in this whole discussion is one of the central aspects of marriage in the first place. Now, most of our culture, our dating scene today, it's focused on physical attraction and on shared hobbies and other things that we share in common with someone, which supposedly makes us compatible with each other. And the general sense is that if my significant other doesn't make me feel amazing, I should find that person out there that will. And after all, you know, we have a soulmate, and, you know, we're meant to find them. And if we find them, they're going to make our dreams come true. That's kind of the general sense. And even if you are married, if you aren't happy with that person that you're married to, you know, maybe you made the wrong decision, and you should find someone else, find that soulmate, find that other person out there who is going to make your life happy. Because happiness is the goal. And you owe it to yourself to be happy. But for the Christian, marriage is not primarily about your happiness. You don't get married to be happy. Now, it's often the result of the things that we do to bless each other in marriage, but happiness is not the goal. It's a frequent but not always guaranteed result of it. The goal of marriage is holiness. It's about growing in conformity to what God has called you to be. So marriage, it's a relationship that is meant to foster a greater life of repentance and faith. It's a relationship that is meant to create a safe environment for you to be vulnerable and for God to work on you, for you to work on your imperfections. It's meant to be a place where you can come face to face with your selfishness, repent of it, and entrust your life to God in faith. Marriage is, essentially, it's meant to be a tool that you can use to help you live a life of repentance of faith. It's meant to help kill off your selfishness rather than letting it fester inside of you and turn you into a self-obsessed monster. Really, a compatible marriage, in the Christian sense, is one in which both people agree to live with each other and support each other as God works to shape them into people that He created them to be. And that often means that your spouse is going to reveal areas of selfishness in you that you didn't realize that you had. And at times, that is not a really enjoyable process. It's not enjoyable to realize how selfish you are, how inconsiderate you are. But it's an important process. And the hope in marriage is that you have someone who will still accept you while you are being shaped by God. They create a safe environment for that change to take place. But in divorce and its cause, that whole process is short-circuited. The process of being able to repent and know that you're accepted is removed. And that's what's so devastating about it. Divorce disregards the fact that we continually need to cultivate a life of repentance and faith. And instead it says, the only people that I will have intimacy with is people who have already arrived. And I don't want to have to confront my selfishness. And so I'm going to find those people who don't make me unhappy. In this way, divorce, it's a particularly anti-law message. It tells you that sin really isn't that big of a deal to work through, both in yours and the other person's life. Divorce in its cause, it disregards our continual need for repentance and faith. Now, if that fourth D is an anti-law message, the fifth D is an anti-gospel message. Because worst of all, divorce in its cause distorts our view of God and His intentions for us. You know, it's really telling that Jesus places His emphasis here on defining what marriage is and what God intended it to be, rather than on creating a whole series of rules to justify when a divorce could rightly occur. That's not the point that Jesus is making here. Now, the rest of Scripture helps us with that. But in this passage, Jesus really just drives home the intention of God in making marriage and the essential nature of what divorce is. He tells us that divorce was never supposed to be a thing, but because of sin, it now is. And what that tells us is that God's desire for us is to bless us, to give us someone who can help us become all that we were meant to be, to give us someone that we can then be a blessing to. That's His intention for us. It isn't for us to suffer. And yet, because sin has entered the world, divorce and the cause of divorce say the exact opposite message to us. Marriage is meant to be, it's created to be the greatest physical demonstration of the gospel message to us in this life. But divorce is perhaps the worst anti-gospel message that we can receive in this life. If someone divorces you, it tells you, you aren't worth fighting for. You aren't worth living with. You aren't worth caring for, putting up with, and sacrificing for. You are not worth it. That's what divorce says. And the reality that we're always dealing with is that when a person we know intimately tells us, that we know intimately, when they tell us something, we have the tendency to put their words into the mouth of God. And so if a stranger tells me, you know, that I should go to hell, it doesn't really affect me. Like, they don't know me. They just know my driving habits. Like, that's all they know, and it doesn't really bother me, okay? But if my wife said that to me, if my father said that to me, I'd feel that in my heart, because I know that they know me well, and I might feel like they're right, and that God might want that for me too. That's the way our intimate relationships affect us, and the way that we talk within them affect the other person. And so if your spouse tells you through divorce or through causing a divorce that you aren't worth dealing with, the effect of it is often an anti-gospel message. Now, there's obviously more that we could talk about here, but in sum, divorce and its cause, which is unfaithfulness to the marital union, disorders our lives, it disintegrates our social relationships, it disrupts our ability to care for our children, it disregards our continual need for repentance and faith, and it distorts our view of God and His intentions for us. So it's all bad. None of it is good, okay? It's a necessary evil at times, but it is all bad. So what's the answer to it? What does Scripture give us other than just saying that it's bad? Well, I encourage you to look at what Jesus actually is saying here and what He does in this text. He doesn't merely condemn all divorce, thereby keeping people in unsafe marriages. And nor does He formulate a way for people to justify their actions, such as by creating a list of acceptable divorces and remarriages. Instead, He calls divorce for what it is, an evil. And He points us to the original intention that God had in marriage. He shows us that God's intention for us in marriage is to bless us. He created it so that we could find fellowship with another person. He created it so that we could cling together for our good, to be joined into one unit. And elsewhere in Scripture, we see that He created it so that we could raise children and transform society for the better. Really, marriage, it's meant to be a gift from God to us, which does the exact opposite of what divorce does to us. It orders our lives, making us more effective. It helps us form lasting relationships in community where we can have unity in the home and also a greater effect on society. It helps us produce and care for children. It helps us come to grips with who we are as sinful people. And it gives us a mechanism by which we can address those imperfections. And it helps us see more of who God is and what He desires for us. That's what marriage is meant to do. And it's that last point that I want to touch on before we end our time together. Because the whole story of Scripture, it's often presented. There's a number of different metaphors that Scripture uses to speak about God's relationship to us. Sometimes there's the image of a father and a son. Sometimes of a king who rescues his people who've been enslaved by a despot ruler. You know, sometimes it's that imagery. But one of the most common images that Scripture uses to describe how God interacts with humanity is that of marriage. It's often put in terms of a marriage between God and humanity. And even if you just take the very beginning of Genesis and the very end of Revelation, the Bible's story begins with a human couple getting married in a garden. And it ends with God, and the God-man, Jesus, marrying His bride, His church, in a garden. From beginning to end, Scripture presents God as a husband who marries His creation, who takes pleasure in her, and who celebrates her. But then it shows us how He became brokenhearted because His wife committed adultery against Him, sought out other gods, other idols, other spouses for herself. But instead of divorcing her and casting her aside, the story takes a turn as He remains faithful in His commitment to love her, even though she has been unfaithful in her commitment to love Him. And so He forgives her of her adultery by taking her sin upon Himself on the cross. He washes her of her sin. He clothes her in a radiant dress. He cares for her. He provides for her. And the story reaches its culmination as he chooses to live with her for all eternity. That he accepts her. The story of Scripture is of a God who is cheated on, but who doesn't throw the marriage aside, but who upholds his commitment to it, and who wins his spouse back to it. It's the story of him making us beautiful through his love for us, rather than him casting us aside because our sin has made us ugly. It's the story of God valuing and loving us even though we did not value or love him. That's the story of the Bible. And that's important for us to see because it says something about how we are called to live in our marriages. Again, I'm not saying that if your spouse commits adultery against you, that you should just always accept them back and never get a divorce. Sometimes there is that divorce is a necessary evil in our human relationships. But for God, divorce was not an option for him. Maybe it was, but he didn't want it to be. And so he won us back, even though he didn't need to. In our marriages, though, especially Christian marriages, we look at Jesus' example, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit's example of how they have loved and accepted us, even though we didn't deserve it. And we say, well, you know, maybe we can do little pictures of that in our marriages. My spouse did not live up to my standards of them. And so I'm going to love and accept them anyways. They did not live up to even necessarily what they agreed to live up to. They were kind of angry with me. They were irritable. I'm going to be kind to them. I'm going to be accepting of them. The reality of what God has done for us in marrying us and treating us in that way changes how we then express our love and our commitment to our spouses. And as a result of that, our marriages are often, they become visible pictures of the gospel to ourselves and to the world around us. They're meant to proclaim the message of forgiveness, of accommodation, of tenderness, of selfless love and commitment. That's what they're meant to communicate to the world. They're meant to show ourselves and the world that we believe in a God who has welcomed us even though we have often run away from him. How he has loved us even though we are often unlovable. How he has been faithful to us even when we have been unfaithful to him. The way that we live within our marriages, it serves as potentially the greatest gospel proclamation that we can make in a world that has so little understanding of what the gospel is. And so my appeal to you today is to see marriage for what it is, to see it as a sign of God's intentions for you. And in those ways that your marriages have not served as that sign, to give them to God, to confess, Lord, evil has been done to me, and I have done evil to others, done evil to my spouse. Would you forgive me of my sin and help me create a marriage that shows your good news to the world? I encourage you to show your spouse and the world around you that you believe in a God who has done such great things to you, who has caused ugliness turn into beauty. How he has taken the sin in your heart and has forgiven you and has produced fruit of righteousness. I encourage you to do that in your marriage. And then in the process, praise God for how he has loved you. Let us pray. Father, I thank you that you have given us yourself, that you have loved us, you've committed to us, even though we are such loveless, commitmentless people. Lord, I ask that you would shape our lives, that whether it's through the difficulties or the joys that happen in marriage, that you would shape us to proclaim your good news to the world around us. In your name we pray, Lord. Amen.